Thank you. Good evening. I would like to invite you, if you feel you would like to have a question in between, just interrupt. Either if you don't understand my English or if you don't understand what I want you to talk about, just interrupt. We'll have time enough. Okay. Let us start out very simply. The category state usually refers to a territory, a people, and an institution which claims the monopoly of legitimate violence. State also implies sovereignty. While this refers to the competence of domination over the people living in the state's territory, it is also the most fundamental principle of international law. If any political unity is internationally accepted as being a state, it is also accepted as being sovereign, i.e., independent in its decisions. And indeed, when the United Nations were founded at the end of the Second World War, its members, regardless of their very different political economies, recognized each other as sovereign states. In other words, international law, if not international politics, abstracts from the social organization of production which is predominant in a certain state. Of course, Marxists endeavoring to analyze the specificities of capitalist state power are not content with the formal definitions of constitutional theories or the principles of international law. Their focus is on the relation between the state and the social organization of the economy. For a long time, socialists theoretically conceived of capitalist states as the coercive instruments of domination. Lenin's conception of the state as being the coercive instrument of the dominant class was in accordance with the everyday experiences of workers and poor people. But Lenin, just like before him Friedrich Engels, was not concerned with the specificities of capitalist state power. When Marxist scholars in the 1970s endeavored to develop a theory of these specificities, they started out with a question which had been formulated by the Russian jurist Eugene Pashukanis in the 1920s. I've just learned that he has been translated now, and has since become very famous. Pashukanis maintained that the capitalist state resembles its historical predecessors in that it is the institution of dominance of a class of a part of the population, but it is distinguished from any other state because in a capitalist state, this dominance is not obvious. Instead, the capitalist state has taken on the form of a public institution which is separated from society. According to Pashukanis, this is the necessary precondition for the capitalist form of exploitation to function. In capitalist societies, those who are to labor are not made to do so by the use of force. Instead, legally equal partners conclude contracts. The result is the subjugation of laborers, but the transactions are not instigated by force, but motivated by market considerations. Once contracts are concluded, the state sanctions their validity through law and jurisdiction. Since civil law is neutral in relation to the contradictions inherent in society, the state is formally separated from these contradictions. It is, in other words, formally separated from the class structure of society. Of course, a theoretical concept like this could only be conceived when trade unions and strikes were no longer criminalized. And this was the case when Pashukanis studied in Germany in the 1920s. Marxists referring themselves to Pashukanis argue that the difference between the equality of citizens in the political sphere and the differences between classes in the economical sphere is the essence of capitalist state power. According to them, this difference, i.e., once again, the separation of the state from society, constitutes the essence of capitalist state power, in other words, its form. That's what they call form analysis. There's hardly any other theoretical concept which has engendered as many misunderstandings. The first thing to understand about this conception of the separation of the state from society, as it was conceived of by Pashukanes and its followers, is that it does not refer to the state's political interference into society. It is not about functions or policies of the state. Therefore, any number of public-private partnerships, nor any extension of economic or social policy, is not to be conceived of as negating the separation of the state from society. Instead, the separation from society is inherent in the equality of citizens before the law. These Marxist theoreticians maintain that the capitalist class character of a state is not proved by any class bias of its policies and its jurisdiction. Instead, the capitalist class character of the state is independent of its policies because it is already present in the equality of citizens before the law. In fact, it is this very neutrality which requires that the state employs its means of violence in order to enforce the stability of the existing order. This results from the fact that the foundation of any capitalist social order is private property, and the law of any capitalist state safeguards private property. In capitalist societies, exploitation has been integrated into the legal foundation of the social order by processes which transform the capacity to labor into a commodity, i.e., into the private property of laborers. Being formally separated from society, the state does not distinguish between the property of machinery, of land, of finance, capital, or of the capacity to labor. Any political action which aims at forcefully changing the existing distribution of private property has to reckon with the full force of the legal means of violence. It is almost unanimously agreed upon that these conditions were instituted through bourgeois revolutions. In what follows, I will try to better explain why the theoretical project of determining the essence of state power is doomed to fail. While proponents of this project in following Pashukanes stated that a theory of the capitalist state which neglects specific historical forms is valid because it refers to basic structures of capitalism. They assumed that these structures would lead to a similar history of capitalism. They were, in fact, proposing a theory of the state in societies where capitalism had been domesticated through labor struggles, but they didn't realize that. The main features of their successes were the end of the criminalization of trade unions and strikes, the development of social policy, and general suffrage. I propose to try to replace an ahistorical theory by historical Marxism. While Marxists as well as non-Marxist historians agreed that capitalism originated in England, most of them also agree that it was the post-revolutionary French state which set the pattern for the further development of bourgeois political forms. Non-Marxist historians uphold that the revolution created a fundamentally liberal bourgeois state which, though being shaken by the turbulences of the revolution, the empire, and further political struggles, became a model for further developments. Its main feature was a constitutional nation state, where male citizens were equal before the law. Insofar as the revolution ended private property of the state's competences, and therefore their use as instruments of private appropriation, it separated the sphere of appropriation from the sphere of political power. While agreeing with this description, Marxist historians maintain that the end of the disturbances of economic competition through the appropriation by means of political power, including the use of legally sanctioned monopolies by merchants, was the historical precondition for capitalist development. Since the interpretation of the French Revolution has been, and still is, central to the analysis of the political forms of capitalism, I am asking your patience for a discussion, albeit a very short one, of this bourgeois revolution. In the context of Marxist state analysis, the result of the French Revolution has usually been claimed to be a capitalist state, i.e., a state in a capitalist society. I disagree. The result of the French Revolution was not a capitalist, but a state in a capitalist society, but in a bourgeois society. While its institutional forms were favorable to later capitalist forms of production, their establishment was neither caused by the necessities of an already existing capitalist society, nor has it immediately accelerated the development of capitalism in France. In order to not only understand the history of capitalism, but also its present-day developments, we have to understand that the relation between the social and the political forms of a society is a bit more complicated than we have been used to think. Dominant Marxist interpretations of the French Revolution are a good example to start out this critique. Let us begin with the assumptions of its historical preconditions. In his comprehensive work on bourgeois revolutions, Neil Davidson has once again maintained that the French Revolution became historically possible because the development of productive forces had reached a stage where the existing forms of property had become fetters to further development. I disagree by maintaining that the French Revolution was provoked by the crisis of the existing forms of domination. In many parts of the European Ancien Régime, jurisdictional, administrative, and military competences had been transformed into means of private appropriation. In France, these competences of the state had even become private property, to be openly purchased on the respective markets and to be passed on as part and parcel of a private heritage. But the French state of the Ancien Régime not only offered the possibility to profit from the fees to which the owners of offices were entitled, but the crown also bestowed nobility. While Marxists have often talked about rich merchants in the times of the Ancien Régime as if they were hoping for the present order to disappear and capitalism to arrive in its stead, historical evidence rather shows that far from being capitalists in spe, most well-to-do merchants were fierce defendants of their legally sanctioned monopolies and, together with their wives, most of them acted like persons who were thinking about the possibility of becoming noble. There's nothing astonishing in this behavior. Humans being social creatures, people more often than not strive to be accepted by their fellow creatures and to socially rise in the society in which they live. In France, a regular path for the acquisition of nobility was opened up when the crown legalized the purchase of offices, thereby legalizing the transformation of parts of the sovereign power of the crown into private property. While the purchase of an office only implied the bestowal of a lower degree of nobility, it did open up possibilities to advance into the higher echelons of the administration and to have the daughters of rich merchants being wed to the sons of impoverished nobles. The continuous demand for offices, as well as the continuous need of the crown for additional income, led to the continuous creation of new offices. This tended to aggravate the domination crisis. Not only were all nobles exempted from direct taxes to the crown, thereby limiting the results of tax collections, but this form of social advancement had its own structural limits. And more offices were created, the possible material gains from office holding tended to dwindle. Conflicts over the right to jurisdiction became everyday practices of government. So did demands of outrageously high fees for administrative services. And in all of this, the crown still had to somehow buy the allegiance of at least some of the members of the high nobility. To be able to do so, the king was in need of additional land and people, i.e. of winning a war. Since this demanded money to start with, the crown had to try to raise new taxes. In order to do so, it was decided in 1788 to fall back on a practice which had been made use of, which had been out of use since 1625, and ask the consent of the estates. This decision was proclaimed at a time when a very bad winter had been followed by a rainy summer in most parts of the kingdom. Bread was scarce and expensive. In some places, tax collectors were attacked. In others, landlords were threatened. All of this was not new. But the convocation of the Etats Généraux transformed widespread unrest into the organization of the Revolutionary Republic. This was furthered when, following traditional practice, the crown asked its subjects to document their grievances in so-called cahiers de doléances. These booklets of grievances then would be, or maybe would not be, answered by the king after the meeting of the estates. But in the course of a local debate on grievances, the most important topic was not the likelihood of the king's answers, but the demand to double the number of representatives of the third estate. There were variations in the right to participate in these debates, but in many villages and towns, every male taxpayer was entitled to take part. About a third of them actually did. Being informed about the demands that were raised in other parts of the kingdom, they became aware of the fact that their own grievances resembled those of people in faraway coins of the kingdom. In other words, the preparation of the booklets of grievances led people to notice the identity of interests among many of the king's subjects. The bulk of grievances concerned the privileges of nobles. 1 year later, revolutionaries proclaimed that they wanted to demolish feudalism. This has very often been misunderstood as proving that until then France had been a feudal society. But when it was decided in the National Assembly in the night of August 4th, 1789, the decisions not only referred to the monetary dues, which formerly had been feudal dues, which were to pay to the landlords, but also to the trade in offices, the multiple sinecures of clergy, the tax exemption of nobles and of some of the towns, and most of all, to all of the various privileges of nobles, amongst them the privilege to hunt or to raise pigeons. The main content of these decisions was the demolition of each one of the legally sanctioned privileges, thereby creating the equality of citizens before the law. The bourgeois form of state, which resulted out of these transformations, had two main components. The first one consisted in the impersonalized power, which was constituted by the simple fact that any private ownership of the state's competences was demolished. Insofar as this impersonalized power of the state belongs to nobody, it henceforth belongs to the nation. Even while the king was still alive, France ceased to be a kingdom, it had become a nation. The second component of the newly constituted bourgeois state power was its heritage, the administrative apparatus, but most of all its sovereignty. When in the middle of the 17th century, European rulers decided to henceforth accept the sovereignty of each other, this signified that they thereby promised to refrain from interference into interior matters of the domination of another sovereign. Most of you will know that this decision was brought about in 1648 by the desire to end a terrible war about the dominance of either Catholicism or Protestantism. The peace treaty of Münster accorded sovereign rulers the right to decide to which of the two Christian creeds the subjects should adhere. While there had been notions of sovereignty before that time, it was only from 1648 onwards that the concept of sovereignty became the most important principle of international law. Bourgeois state power inherited the sovereignty of its predecessor. Some of you will ask themselves, and what about the class struggle in all of this? While I prefer to limit the use of the theoretical concept of class conflict to the explanation of the contradictory relation between exploiters and exploited, without confounding this concept with the assumption of a struggle between social groups. And while I also prefer to restrict the use of this theoretical concept to capitalist societies, I am willing to forget about these reservations for the moment. Ellen Maxins Wood, in order to criticize the interpretation of the French Revolution as a capitalist revolution, insists that this revolution was fought by, by professionals, office holders, and intellectuals. She forgot artisans, apprentices, poor townspeople, peasants, and of course women. She is, nevertheless, correct in insisting that there was not much of class struggle inherent in the critique of the privileges of the nobility. On the other hand, peasants attacking tax collectors or destroying the documents about the dues they were to pay to their landlord amounted to attacks on the source of their exploitation. And indeed, through all of the changes in the political course of the revolution, French peasants managed to defend their property in land, be this ever so small and ever so meager. Since in France, peasants had been the main source of direct taxes to the king, jurisdiction had prevented the expropriation of peasants, thereby also preventing the practice of enclosures, which in the Kingdom of England aggravated the poverty of men and tenants and led to their being chased from the land. In France, peasants' property in land not only survived the Ancien Régime, but also the revolution more or less unimpaired. Therefore, not only the number of wage laborers, but also the productivity of agrarian production remained relatively limited for quite some time. There were, of course, manufacturers, but more and more specialists of French society, social and economic history have come to agree that capitalism did not really become dominant in France before the middle of the 19th century, some even deciding on a much later date. These findings, and I think they are convincing, contradict any notion of the French Revolution as being a capitalist revolution and of the resulting state being the state of a capitalist society. While in England, capitalism developed in political forms which were still very much Ancien Régime in character, and while even after the destruction of most of the legally sanctioned monopolies in the English Revolution, very many of these forms either stayed on or were restored, French capitalism developed after the institutional forms of a capitalist state had already been in place for almost a century. In other words, the relation between the economic forms of capitalism and its political forms, or, to use the terms having been applied in the context of orthodox Marxism, between base and superstructure, are not as unilateral as many Marxists were wont to assume. I will try to better explain this statement by reflecting about the theoretical concept of free wage labor, i.e., the legal form of labor which Marxists have taken to not only be dominant in capitalism, but to also be essential for labor to be profitable for capital owners. Once again, any theoretical conviction about strict relations of necessity between capitalism and legal forms is contradicted by historical developments. In England, all subjects of the king had been legally free since the 14th century. Being no longer serfs, peasants were no longer bonded to the land. They became tenants, i.e., economically but not legally subjugated to landowners. In case they were not able to pay the lease, tenants more often than not lost their leaseholds, usually ending up as wage laborers. Most of them remained in the countryside. Later, more and more searched work in towns. Being freed persons, these poor people were legally free to sell their capacity to labor, but they were not legally free to end their contract at will. This freedom was only accorded English wage laborers in 1875, i.e., at a time when English capitalism dominated the world. Even if not every master took legal action for a breach of contract, laborers who did have to appear before court were regularly condemned to a stint in prison. Arriving there, they were flogged. During their stay, they usually experienced forced labor. The law which was applied in these cases originated in the Master and Servant Act of 1562. It was, in other words, part and parcel of an economy which was not separated from the state. The state restricted competition in the market as far as labor markets were concerned. These restrictions continued long after the advent of capitalism. The end of punishment of breaches of labor contracts was not brought about by the necessities of capitalism. It only came about after the extension of suffrage in 1868 induced members of parliament to think about ways of winning the votes of laborers. In other words, in order to explain the history of the basic legal form of capitalist exploitation, we have to also consider developments in the sphere of politics. Let me emphasize the theoretical relevance of this statement by, once again, referring to development in France. Having been recognized as citizens in the course of a revolution, French workers already at the end of the 18th century possessed the freedom to conclude as well as to end any labor contract. The revolution had created the legal form of wage labor, which we have come to consider as being necessary for capitalism. But this was not necessitated by capitalism in France, but by the need to legitimate the revolution. In proclaiming to the world their right to abolish any legal differences of status, revolutionaries had to refer themselves to the natural rights of men. The equality of citizens before the law came to be one of the most consistent heritages of the revolution, not even tempered with by Napoleon when he created his new own aristocracy. Endeavoring to replace philosophical convictions about the path of history with actual historical research, we are forced to realize that capitalism is an economic system which is based on the exploitation of labor and functions through competition, but is otherwise adaptable to a rather wide range of political and legal forms. This implies that modern slavery has also been made use of as a capitalist form of exploitation. I will leave that aside. Having started out to explain that in France bourgeois forms of state power were established and capitalist forms of production were not yet dominant, I will now follow this up by stating that the exportation of the institutional forms of bourgeois states to post-colonial societies are not to be mistaken for the separation of the state from society in these societies. In order to better explain this statement, I must invite you to once again consider some pre-capitalist developments in Europe. If bourgeois revolutions were inspired by considerations of status and of material gains, their historical possibility also emerged out of very specific developments in the history of thought and of mentality in Europe. There was, first of all, the effect of the struggle over the reform of the church. This not only led to the definite establishment of the principle of sovereignty, but also to the secularization of domination. If for a very long time bourgeois states proclaimed an official Christian creed, the struggle over the reform had nevertheless thoroughly demolished the religious foundations of domination. Bourgeois state power, as much as it was made use of to discriminate Jews and members of the not officially recognized Christian denominations, was secularized power. But the Christian religion, even if it no longer considered to be the foundation of legitimate domination, also contained a lasting contribution to one of the most important traits in the European history of mentalities. By proclaiming the existence of a direct relation between each and every believer and his God, the Christian religion also proclaimed the relevance of individual persons. Historical research discovered that during the European Ancien Régime, most Christians, some of the priests not excluded, had little knowledge about theology. This did not prevent that Christianity furthered the mentality of individualism, thereby also preparing the concept of citizenship as being a direct relation between legally free individuals and the state. From the 17th century onwards, individualism, even if it was not yet present in much of everyday social practice, became intertwined with the concept of interests. Unfortunately, Orthodox Marxism has conceived of interests as being the simple reflects of the material situation of people. Even in this altogether deplorable notion, interests are linked with behavior. This notion was already present when, in the course of the 17th century, the word interest took on a second meaning. No longer exclusively referring to payments for a loan, but also to the sources of people's behavior. While it had long been customary to only trust the behavior of people who shared one's religious creed, many now started to consider that others behaved according to their interests. This, however, was not assumed to arise of some sort of unconscious reflex of one's material conditions of life, but out of debates about these conditions. Interests, though being considered to be owned by individuals, have right from the start been conceived of as being produced by communication, i.e., by the social group to which an individual wants to belong. Before you start to be convinced that this whole discussion about interest is not more than theoretical sophistry, I would like to point out that in the European Ancien Régime, many people were trained in conceiving their interests. Members of guilds, brotherhoods of artisans, members of town councils, of village assemblies, they all had been engaged in the practice of deciding about demands and actions which could somehow be considered as the essence of many individual aims. This practice of debates about interests was one of the preconditions for the constitution of bourgeois state power. Everywhere, bourgeois revolutions started with the development of public debates about the shortcomings of the present forms of domination and about interests. In all of these debates, it became clear that while some objectives were shared by many of those who demanded change, others were not only different, but even contradictory. I will try to explain the relevance of these historical arguments by applying them to the analysis of those sub-Saharan post-colonial states which aligned themselves with the USA. After having acquired their independence in the second half of the 20th century, these states were modeled according to the formal organizations of bourgeois state power. If this had indeed been the aim of many of the leaders in the struggle for independence, it was also furthered by the acceptance of political realities in the field of international policies. Post-colonial states could only choose between the two blocs, but not between much else. But the adoption of bourgeois political forms has not, at the same time, amounted to actually separate the state from society. Instead, in many African societies of today, the legal and administrative powers of the state are made use of for private appropriation. Social scientists have termed these developments privatization of the state. When African colonies first gained their independence, this privatization was not immediately present. Post-colonial states, having aligned themselves with the Western political bloc, received large sums from the USA. Officially declared to be aids for the development of the country, it was well known to everybody concerned that large sums were made use of for the building of villas, the purchase of private cars, or other matters of luxury. This notwithstanding, there was also economic development during the era of the post-war international high conjuncture. But in the 1970s, African societies, as well as the personnel of their governments, suffered doubly. When a worldwide economic crisis replaced the post-war international economic conjuncture, this affected production in highly industrialized countries and thereby also the demand for raw materials from Africa. At the same time, the ice of the Cold War started to thaw, freeing the US and its allies of the necessity to continue large sums on the political loyalty of post-colonial states. The Cold War had produced a sort of political rent for the political elites in Africa. When this rent no longer arrived, the competition about the best possibility to use political power for private appropriation intensified. It was in this time that the argument about undue dominance of one ethnic group in the state apparatus became part and parcel of political strife in sub-Saharan Africa. For the bulk of the population, conditions deteriorated when, from the 1980s onwards, the International Monetary Fund and World Bank offered loans to developing countries. They offered them under the condition of reforms which aimed at reducing the costs of government. Thus, international creditors decided important points of national budgets. Their conditions concerned the reduction of the costs of social policy, as well as the costs for public health care and for public education. And it was in this time of crisis that more and more people expected of politicians that they forget about the nation and rather take care of their tribe. If a politician manages to prevent that everybody has the chance to make use of new opportunities, this will be declared corruption by foreign observers, as well as by political activists in his own country. But his or her behavior will usually be lauded by the people in his or her village and the members of his or her tribe. In sub-Saharan African states, The state has the institutional form of a public institution, but this public character of the state is more or less fictitious. Policies are mostly decided upon in the networks of family, tribe, and ethnicity. Just like in the times of colonial domination, the state is the instrument of exploitation for private gains. Activists trying to change these practices are not only confronted with the need of poor people to better their life through the paths which are actually open to them, but also by the practices of international capital. Not only native businessmen, but also the representatives of international big capital are willing to pay for licenses, be they genuine or fake. And not only governments, but also private individuals profit from the sale of licenses to produce oil, to export rare commodities, to dump dangerous waste, and so on. When politicians in leading capitalist countries demand good governance from developing countries, they usually omit that corruption has long been married to the practices of international capital. These developments have been furthered by a severe economic crisis, the policies of so-called structural reforms, as well as by present-day practices of international capital. I nevertheless suggest that we should also take into consideration that the adoption of the institutional forms of bourgeois state power may not have helped to effect the separation of the state from society, because pre-capitalist traditions of African societies have not contained practices of determining individual rights and interests. If the institutional forms of bourgeois state power cannot immediately function in societies where debates about the interests of individuals were either absent or had been prohibited, this stabilizes practices which aim at bettering the life of the members of one's family or tribe. These practices hinder debates of needs and aims of individuals which are considered independently of traditional responsibilities toward family or tribe. If communication about interests was prohibited in colonies of European powers, it was deemed superfluous in societies of the Soviet Union. In the Soviet type of socialism, the true interests of people were to be discovered and acted upon by the party, not to be the result of public discussions outside of the party. In post-socialist societies, political interests came to be debated early on, but much of everyday life, was still organized by way of making use of the connection to somebody who knew somebody, who again knew somebody who may be able to help. In other words, many tried to better their life outside of the official channels of economy and independently of the proclamations of the party. This sort of practice relies more on the credence of personality than on any organization which proclaims to further interests which had been discussed in public debates. Some remnants of these practices seem to be still present in the eastern part of Germany. My final example of capitalist state power concerns one of the most important political forms of globalized capitalism, the creation of so-called offshore conditions. Its foundation is the sovereign power of states. Since the 1960s, political unities become sovereign states through their acceptance as members of the United Nations. They are thereby officially granted the exclusive competence to rule over their nation, its territory, and its riches. Very few exceptions apart, governments in former times used to insist that the law of the state was general, applying to all of its territory and all of its citizens. But sovereign states have the competence to also decree exceptions. The creation of offshore conditions is just that. It amounts to the constitution of a legal exclave from the generality of the law. States constituting offshore conditions advertise their advantages on the respective world markets in order to attract foreign investors. Many offshore conditions concern possibilities for tax evasions. In spite of growing international critique, they are still thriving. Amongst the earliest forms of offshore conditions to be offered were so-called flags of convenience. Ship owners register ships in states offering these flags in order to save taxes, but most of all, in order to make use of the absence of any regulation about the nationality of the crews. These ship owners can legally hire seafarers on the world maritime labor market without having to worry about legal struggles. The most important enticement to use offshore conditions for production processes in faraway countries has also been the offer of cheap labor. The states creating offshore conditions usually declare that not only criminal laws, but also environmental laws, as well as regulations for labor security, are also valid in offshore zones. Alas, the international competition over investments constitutes economic spheres of capitalism where the state is more or less absent. Terrible accidents in the production centers of textiles, like the ones having occurred in Bangladesh, or a high number of suicides, like those having been committed in firms where fiercely exploited workers in China produce gadgets for Apple, usually gain the notice of a critical international public at least for a few weeks. But until now, the globalized competition of capital as well as the globalized competition of laborers has not weakened but rather strengthened the existence of offshore zones. There have been strikes of laborers, and in some countries with very extensive offshore production, managers have come to limit the duration of labor contracts to 3 or 4 years, thereby trying to safeguard their profits against the resistance of men and women who have been informed about their rights. But until the very day, offshore zones have historically demonstrated that in cases of very intensive competition in the markets for cheap labor, capital owners can act as coercive power without recourse to the state. Let me sum up. Any theoretical project aiming at the explanation of the general character of capitalist political forms is doomed to fail. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for your lecture, and now the floor is open for questions from the audience. If there won't be any, maybe you could talk a bit more about your methodological considerations about classes and why they are not useful or legitimate before.
But when I was just teaching in university, I usually said, well, often when we read about class struggle, it's something like a football match. There's a class on one side and a class on the other side, and then they are struggling. It's considered as groups of people struggling. But I think it's wrong. And Marx, when he really did do historical analysis of France, he didn't use that concept of class struggle either. He was talking about different interests of people, of estates, of different what they wanted to have, but he didn't say there's class struggle. We took that from the preface, the famous preface of the Communist Manifest, but it's really, it's a political propagandist concept. It's not a concept that helps us to analyze class, the relation. I think what is necessary is to analyze that there are interests of people that are contradictory. But the development, for example, I myself use the concept of class struggle only for capitalism. Because if we use it, then we say this contradiction, these conflicts of different interests, they also are relevant for the development of capitalism, because capital then tries to make production cheaper, they try to have more machinery and things like that. They try to change the situation of how they are going to make a profit. But if we apply these to pre-capitalist societies, we do not take into consideration what most important form for the development of these societies. In the European feudalism, the most important form of competition was competition by war, by warfare. And that was also the form where the most progress was made. The warfare was really was the center of progress. And that's easily explained because people gained riches by gaining land and people. And so they had to try to extensify their domination. There was a class relation, a direct class relation between the peasants, of course, and the landlords. But the development of the feudal societies was much more pushed by the competition between those who had the power to make warfare.
Okay, thank you. We have more questions. Well, maybe two actually, but both are short, so I'll use both. You said that Christianity was conducive to the development of individualism. Okay. Now, I know you do not agree with his definitions of state and capitalism, but is there a small hint of Max Weber in this? And if so, do you see any differences between Protestantism and Eastern and Western traditions of Catholicism in the conduciveness of individualism? The other question is, you put strong emphasis on the universalization and the personalization of power. What do you think about claims that this process is becoming once again reversed today? Is this more of a rhetorical claim, or is there any productive conceptual value in such claims?
I'll have to ask you about the second question. The first, of course, there's a hint of Max Weber. that's true, because he already debated that. Recent historical research has also shown that even in Catholic countries, after the Reformation, there was much more individualism. Because in the, even in Western Catholicism, it's a different concept, because the priest is between the individual Christian and God. And But in the times of conflict, even in France, where it was the official creed, there was much more private religion. I can't pronounce that. Much more religious practice than before, and they did not so much depend on priests than before. So I don't think there's a very much difference between the two. I don't know enough about the Eastern Catholicism. Mm-hmm. But I think we shouldn't overdo that with the Christian I'm getting to be too tired to find the English words. With the relevance of Christianity for the development of individual, but there is something in there. Okay, the second one you have to explain again. I stressed the importance of the generalization of dominion. Do you mean in one state or in the world? I didn't quite get your second question. Can you repeat that?
Okay, you have, for instance, critical sociologists in Slovenia who are talking about a subsidiary state where, once again, there are, I don't know, banker elites that nobody can do anything against. This would be the most simple example. So are such claims more rhetorical coming from leftists, or is there any conceptual value in this? Is dominion within a country changing today?
Yes, of course. Of course it's changing. But that doesn't say that the state isn't relevant. In any case, it's relevant for political struggles. They are still led in the national sphere. And the state is very, very important in the international sphere. Even if today, well, I didn't go into that. I don't know if you have followed the debate about the new contract between the US and the EU. You certainly have followed that. And about the private courts where firms are supposed to have the same right as states, which already does exist, by the way. Mm-hmm. Outside of this contract, it already does exist. So we are seeing that. I would still hesitate to say that capital has taken away the relevance of the state. We did that at the beginning of the globalization. Everybody said, well, the state is not important anymore. It's just capital that is deciding. I think we can see today that the state is very important. It is even important for the offshore zones because it creates those zones. And then it's absent in the functioning, but it creates those zones. And that's where a lot of capitalism today takes place. And for some time, people have thought that if there's a lot of competition between the production, for example, in China, they don't only produce textile; they also produce a lot of communication technology. And they thought, well, if they do that in offshore zones, they will have to have a better educated labels, but in the meantime, it has been shown they are able to transform the labor process. Though they have part of their specialized labels, but the others they can still use very cheap labor. So we can't hope that offshore zones in themselves, like for example with the International Labor Organization, they expected that in the course of time they would need to have better qualified laborers and they would need to attract laborers and to give better conditions, but we don't see that. So I think the state is very important in still creating these possibilities. And of course the state is important in creating possibilities of the exploitation of labor in developed countries too.
Okay, we still have time for questions.
Can we go back to the notion of a bourgeois state? Can you explain what are the characteristics of the bourgeois state? I suppose if we have a concept of bourgeois state, then we have also a concept of state before it, feudal state. And if the bourgeois state is not related to capitalist mode of production, then what defines it?
Yes, I think I've tried to do that. It's defined by the equality of citizens before the law and the absence of, and this also means the absence of legally sanctioned differences between estates and legally sanctioned privileges. And this, of course, means also that there's no private ownership of the state competences. I myself don't use...
But it was already Magna Carta that determines the...
Ah, you have to be careful to Magna Carta was only for the nobles. The nobles decided that they didn't want to have the king decide for himself, because the king had just lost the war. And then the nobles said, well, we are not going to accept that anymore. England, I didn't go into that. The difference between France and England is very interesting, because at first the king had much more power in England, because the king was victorious at first, and the nobles were really, really subjugated to the king. They had to follow him, and they did not own the land at first. And so in England, the nobles did not have private property of jurisdiction, like in France. Even in the 18th century, some landlords could still decide about the life of a peasant. Not very many, but some still. In England, that ended in the 13th century. And the nobles were much more of rich people. That's why it was much easier in England to integrate the upcoming merchants with former nobility, because it was not so much the ownership of competences, but it was the ownership of riches. And this was furthered a lot with the English practice of heritage. As you probably know, if you read English novels, novels of the English aristocracy, only the eldest son inherited. In France, in most parts of France, all the children inherited. That's why. That's why they were. Some of them were really poor in France, but in England not. So they could still keep. They could still keep the dominance when they were rich merchants, because they were rich also. And rich merchants then became also members of the we still have it today. We have two
houses.
The House of Lords. Thanks. Thanks. Yes. In 1928, the first brewer was member of the House of Lords, and then some of the lords said, "Well, no, it's really." Ended.
Okay. Any more questions? Okay, Steve.
Thank you. Can I return to the question of a class struggle and why you only use it for capitalism? And in your reply to Jan, you said that basically seem to introduce, maybe I misunderstood, but you seem to introduce as a decisive criteria for the possibility of using class struggle to explain certain conflicts or processes, the question of to what extent it is, let's put it like this, a motor of progress. So earlier it was warfare, and later on in capitalism, arguably, well, the capital labor and wage labor relation is what pushes at least technological and economic development. But the question then, my question would be, why should this criteria of progress, and then the question is, of course, what kind of progress? Merely technological, economic, or even political? But you yourself have shown that political and economic do not travel
unison.
Yeah. So, but the fundamental question is, why should this be defining criteria for using class, the notion of class struggle as Because it seems quite rigid and in some extent also still indebted to a very old orthodox concept in the sense of the motor of progress, of historical progress. And why even enter that terrain, which seems to burden, it seems to be a very large explanatory burden for the concept of cluster.
Yes, I did use the word progress, didn't I? it's good that you formulated that question, because I'm really against that theory of historical progress. It's one of my topics. Maybe you'll allow a few sentences about the book that I'm writing at the moment. I seem to always have criticized traditional Marxist concepts. One of the most relevant Marxist concepts was that capitalism was the precondition for socialism, and it was also progress in relation to feudalism. That's in Marx and Engels and in traditional theory. And one of the... So capitalism in that relation is also conceived of as progress. And one of the main contents of this theory was that capitalism was better than feudalism because in the exploitation of labor there was no longer violence, but the market. And that's in the ursprüngliche Akkumulation, how is it in English? Previous accumulation and the theory of previous accumulation. And Marx and many Marxists thought that after the previous accumulation, violence is no longer necessary for development of capitalism. And the book I'm writing at the moment shows that, I think it shows, that capital owners use violence if they are not hindered to use it. And that in capitalism there is no economic rationality which prevents the use of violence. That's one of the reasons why I say slavery was a form of capitalist exploitation. So I criticize these concepts of progress. I wouldn't say capitalism in some relations is better than it was in former times. Of course, in some relations it is. But we do not have progress which is built in the economic forms. So that's why I usually don't use the term progress. I should have used the term decisive for its historical development when I talked about feudalism. And because those who had more land and could lead more war, they became richer, and that also enabled them to subjugate the nobles. That's what we can see in France very easily. In the German Reich, we didn't have that. The Kaiser couldn't really rule about the nobles. But in France, they could because they were successful in their wars. So I should have used the word historical development, but I shouldn't have used the word progress, because that always assumes a historical philosophy of progress, which I criticize very much. Did I make myself clear?
To some extent, Orthodox Marxism said class struggle is the defining motor of history. Mm-hmm. And then you say, well, in feudalism, in that sense, it wasn't the driving force of development, of change. This was, in fact, warfare between as aristocrats. Mm-hmm. But
therefore this cannot be class struggle, or class struggle cannot be decisive for that period, for the third revolution, you're still basically taking in as a premise the Orthodox Marxist notion that class struggle has to be, in that sense, a monocausal motor of historical development.
No, I don't. No, it's class struggle is important for the conflicts over the production of profit. But class struggle is not determinant for politics. There goes a lot into the of course, sometimes class struggle goes into politics, but it doesn't determine the development of politics. And my argument is that we have to take much more seriously the term political economy as Marxism. It's really a political economy, and it's not. The economy is not only decided in the economic sphere, but it's decided by political decisions. And political decisions are not only decided by economic considerations and economic interests. That's one of the reasons why I say that in post-colonial countries, in Africa, I use the example of Africa because I know a little bit more about those than about others. Since they didn't have the same traditions, they don't have the same political claims. So it's much more difficult to fight capitalist practices if you only have the tribe and capital. I wish you try that again. It's difficult to say in English. Anyway, I wouldn't say that class. I don't say class struggle is the decisive. I don't adhere to that notion that class struggle is the decisive. How do you formulate that then? Decisive motion
for historical development.
It's decisive for history. It is present, but it's not always decisive.
But I think Stieper was asking. Okay, but isn't class also something else? Like, maybe there were still classes even though they were not historical development motors and stuff like that.
Yes, of course, that's what I said. The relation between feudal lords and peasants was a class relation. But the fight between feudal lords and peasants did not change the domination so much as the competition between the lords.
So then the criteria is realized. I try to understand now. Why do you need the notion that is so widely used and seemingly non-controversially, because everybody agrees there were wars of peasants in Germany, especially, of course, against the feudal lords. So this is an instance of class struggle. Why introduce a criteria such as it has to be the deciding moment in transforming social relations to call it class struggle?
I don't think I understand what you mean at the moment.
I could try in German, but.
Oh, yeah. But then I still have to answer in English.
Yeah.
So
it doesn't make sense. No. Well, maybe you can later on. It's not so important. Okay,
so maybe we're getting a little tired. Any more urgent questions? No. So thank you for your visit and your questions. And this is for the call for today. Thank you.